Today's topic, high-rise buildings, planning and design. Sorry for a bit late, because of this sharing and issues. So today we'll be talking about these high-rise buildings. The contents of the topic are high-rise buildings and need of high-rise buildings. We'll talk about structural systems, dynamic analysis and effect of wind, planning and management and construction techniques of high-rise buildings and safety in high-rise building and high-rise projects by our company, Satyavani Projects and Consulting. So high-rise building is a tall building that we have different categories actually. High-rise, tall, or skyscrapers like that. So we have a separate code for tall buildings like 16700, which are applicable up to 250 meters tall building. And as per definition of National Building Code, any building that is beyond 15 meters high comes under high-rise buildings as per National Building Code. And it is also referred as, if it is a residential building, it is also referred as multi-dwelling units. So this is the definition of high-rise, and we all know today's need for high-rise buildings, whether it is offices or residential or hotels, because of the rising population, urbanization, and also the land costs, rising land costs. In fact, we should not plan high-rise buildings where the land costs are lower than 20 crores per acre. This is my high-rise means beyond 30 meters, tall buildings. So this is the main importance thing, because the cost of construction keeps growing as we increase the number of floors. So when we talk about high-rise, first we should take the tallest building in the world at present. That is, height is 829.8 meters, world's tallest. And really it's a living wonder. For me, I would have visited this structure at least 6 times so far. That's such a fascinating, as a structural engineer, it's a wonder. I treat the designer of this Burj Khalifa as a god for myself. And he's a living god for me. I mean, the one who can imagine the forces in such structure, and it is designed the most optimal way, the most optimum structural system without great technology. He has used reinforcement concrete only. He has used a column beam structure with shear walls and core. And he has used these things only to optimize the loading as well as the structural design. So next comes the South Beach development. There are so many high-rise buildings in the world. And we can see the Singapore's ideal city in a garden kind of design, where the buildings, high-rise buildings, also have this kind of facilities. And so we should look at all the high-rise buildings. Bly Street, Australia, you can see this a fully glazed tower. Even, of course, Burj Khalifa also has glazing, a specially designed glazing. And this is the signature tower in Jakarta, 111th story, and Tanjong Pagar Center in Singapore. In fact, these high-rise buildings or tall buildings, skyscrapers, are the wonder creation of the human beings, actually. This is the really, wherever we go to these cities where these high-rise buildings are seen, it's a pleasure to the eye. Like nature, when we see, we feel relaxed and seen. And when we see this, we pat our back as human beings. It is the creation of human beings. Such a tall buildings and design and the form and utility. So we should, and this is the Trump Tower, Manila, a luxury hotel in 250 meters, 61 story tall. And top and bottom corners peel away. This is the challenge here, actually, in the facade. Actually, its structure is same, but it looks like you have peeled the corner here and you have peeled the corner here. So that is the beauty of this design. And Shanghai Tower, here if you see this, this has a structural importance actually to reduce the loading, wind loading on the structure actually. So these are all the just introduction to the high-rise buildings. As the rise in land prices and high population densities created, like Hong Kong, places like Hong Kong, places like Singapore, where the land is limited and the population is growing. So there is no option but to go for high-rise and no option but to go for small areas of the living dwelling units. In Hong Kong, a very rich person, a billionaire, also lives in a small area. So that is the compulsion actually. Maybe in India also will be forced to have such small spaces because of the rising land prices, and affordability becomes very tough. So we have to start designing these things. The next important thing is, when we talk about this high-rise buildings, we have to understand the basic behavior of the structural element. So first we have to understand the basic things like tension, compression, and because we'll be testing our forces in all, like if we design a normal beam in a of 10 meter span, probably we'll design for flexure primarily. And if you design a beam, deep beam, you primarily design for shear. But in high-rise buildings, when we do, we have to deal with all the forces, tension, compression, secondary effects, temperature effects, even the creep, we have to calculate and do this. So that is the, when it comes to high-rise buildings, so we have to be very clear about these forces and how to deal with these forces. And next is the structural systems. What are all the types of structural systems we have for high-rise? We have the shear truss, like we have a cantilever towers we design. So in towers, like we have a truss. So same way in high-rise buildings also, high-rise building is also a tower. So we have to design for these forces, wind forces primarily, using the concept of the truss, concept of shear wall, and the concept of core supported outrigger system, and combination of these systems. So this is how we, as we move high rise, as I said, up to 15 meters, we can treat it as normal building. But beyond 15 meters, we'll go for rigid frames, is it not? And beyond 30 meters, up to 30 meters, you can go for rigid steel frames. And then as you move beyond 30 meters, you have to have a shear core with the concrete shear wall with the steel hinged frames is okay. Next, you have to go for braced rigid frames with the shear core. And then as you move higher, you can have concrete shear walls with steel rigid frame. And then concrete shear wall plus concrete frame. This is treated as a tubed frame. And beyond 80 meters and all, we go for outrigger supported systems. So this is the type of structural systems. So we have to understand the behavior of this structural system. And primarily in the high-rise structures, in the normal up to 15 floors, primary forces are dead load, live load. And as we move, and also earthquake, of course. But as we move higher and higher, the wind forces become predominant actually. The wind velocity increases as we move up, and also the dynamic effects of the wind on the structure. So, and the comfort of the people living in such structure is very important. So the codes, high-rise codes, limit the lateral drift, and also the when the structure responds to these forces, the acceleration, response also is very important. We have to keep it in limits, like vibration we call, like vibration or movement. We have to limit it as per the caudal provision. And also this story drift will affect your windows and windows primarily, glazed windows or facade that we are using. So there were cases when first Empire State Building was constructed, there were window panes falling and some people are injured also. So then they brought in that regulation to limit this deformation or sway in the structure, so that the window, and also special design for the windows. And even the masonry, you cannot construct brick wall like we do in the normal building. So masonry also we have to design for this lateral drift and all that. And so these are all the special things. Every part of the building has to be engineered, whether it is window or, 16700 is the tall buildings code in India right now. And don't just follow it as a rule, but as an engineer, you should interpret the clauses and then design this structure. And a shear wall is designed as a vertical cantilever fixed at the base, and the connecting beam forces the walls to act as single unit by restraining their individual cantilever actions, and that is the shear wall. These are coupled, and we can also design as coupled shear walls. So this is the typical shear wall system. See, you have the central core and you have a shear wall here, and you have the bracings. This is actually infill also, you can treat it as a bracing, but only compression strut. And this is the base isolation. As we move taller, it is always better to have the base isolation system, because you can't design for the entire seismic forces. Normally in high seismic zones, we should desist from going high rise because of the cost and safety issues that are there. If you see these world's tallest building in Dubai, because Dubai doesn't fall under high wind or very high earthquake zones. Even Britain doesn't fall under high earthquake zone. So you do, in Japan, they have done up to 50 floors and 60 floors, but not definitely very high rise, because it won't be viable. So shear wall concept has become very popular now in almost all the cities, thanks to company MyOne. So it has become very popular because of its advantage in constructability and also the shear wall. But like this is a, I mean, not a very good example I'm showing. It should not be used. That's why I'm showing. I mean, having like this transverse floors and shear walls above is not a real shear wall and not a real safe thing. So we should desist from such a structural system and try to design. What is wrong if you take this wall down here, for example? Like that, we have to fix the structural system in high-rise buildings mainly. We have to fix the structural system and then go for planning, in fact, not the other way around. It will be very uneconomical. Yeah, shear walls have to be detailed for ductile requirements, like shear reinforcement and confinement reinforcement are very important. And shear walls are not only designed to resist vertical loads, but also to lateral loads like earthquake and wind. And they are structurally integrated with the diaphragm, floor diaphragm. That is very important. The whatever rigid diaphragm slab we have, it has to be integrated with the shear wall. So here you can see, if it is not done properly, the joining and the shear wall, this is what is going to happen. And so these are all the different classification of shear walls. It is a simple rectangle type shear wall, and we have this coupled column supported. This is not a shear wall really, but where you are forced, this is how we can do. Try to make it like an opening rather than making it like a column. And this is the core type and this is the rigid type. In fact, coupled means there will be two shear walls connected, and this is the rigid frame and this is the framed type. So reinforced concrete shear walls, you have a foundation and you have the diaphragm like this slab connected to the shear wall, and also here every floor slab is connected to the shear wall, and you have the beam and connected to the shear wall. And the rigid frames may be combined with reinforced concrete shear walls to create shear wall frame interaction. And then that the joint detailing is very important. You have to study all the forces in the beams in the junction with the shear wall, like torsion, shear, secondary shear, axial force and all that. And for up to 35 floors, this shear wall, shear truss concept is okay. So these are all the old buildings, you can see. And this is a auditorium building. And this is a Reliance building and Daniel. So these are all the high-rise buildings even constructed 100 years back. And these are all the structural systems, like you can see the shear truss and the combination of shear truss and shear wall. And here you can see the braced frames. These are all the braced frames. And this is also braced shear wall. And a rigid frame, like Lakeshore Drive in Chicago. And now let us see the interaction between shear wall and the frame. So if it is frame alone, it will behave like this. If it is the shear wall alone, it will behave like this. You can see the mode shape. This is the first mode shape. This is the second mode shape. And combined will reduce the overall deformation, but you can see the forces acting. Here there will be a tension and here there will be a compression between these two. So we have to take care of these forces while designing the joint between the shear wall and the frame. This is the thing. In fact, we have to study first any tall building, don't jump onto the computer first. We have to study manually what is from even classical equations. We have to estimate the forces and then have an understanding of the level of force, then decide the structural system. And again, do 2-3 iterations when manually and then go modeling on the computer. That is how it should be done. And this is the core supported outrigger system. So here, this is the core and you have the columns which are having this diaphragm, rigid diaphragm outrigger. And so that will, advantage of this is, suppose if you don't have outrigger, this is your bending moment diagram. So because of the outrigger will reduce the forces. Changes in, so this is the best outrigger system in at present in Taipei, 101 floors. And this also has, if you observe here, in the first 60 floors or 60 meters, this doesn't have the outrigger because they have used the super column here. And beyond this, it is the outrigger actually. So we should study different cases when we are deciding the, so the value engineering plays a great role in this high-rise buildings. I'll take the questions towards the end. And exterior structures now, we have frame tubes, we have brace tubes, and we have bundle tube, we have tube in tube, diagrid, which became very popular of late recently because of diagrid system considered for a 50-story structure in Amravati, which of course is on hold now or scrapped. And space truss system, super frame system, and exoskeleton system. So let us look at these things, applicability of these exterior structures. So this up to 60 floors, you can go for tube frame, we call it tube frame. And this is the steel frame tube, you can go up to 80 floors because of the resilience. So steel has got a lot of resilience compared to concrete actually. And tube in tube is this system, also you can use with concrete. And concrete braced tubes you can have, that is braced and tubed. And you have steel braced tube here, and here it is diagrid. This is the exact diagrid. And you have exoskeleton here and a steel bundle tube here. Bundle tube is what you have seen. Best example is, you should prompt me whenever I don't do it. I am into explaining rather than bothering about your convenience of seeing. Yeah, that's a good suggestion, Raghavendra. So this is the diagrid and this is the exoskeleton you can see. Exoskeleton is nothing but a portal with a latticed column and latticed beam like that. So this is the latticed column and latticed beam. And this is the bundle tube. And this is a concrete bundle tube. And you have the steel brace tube. And this is the space truss concept. And this is the super frame concept. So the World Trade Center was a super frame actually. And this is Bank of China space truss and a steel brace tube and all that. So, sorry, where are we? So this is the frame tube. Basically, the concept of, the beauty of this frame tube is it is conceived by Fazlur Khan, who is from Bangladesh, settled in US, of course. So he is inspired by bamboo, structure of the bamboo. If you observe, bamboo is the natural tall structure, basically. So bamboo has got the tube, actually. It is a tube, is it not? So he felt that structure also we have to, because bamboo resists wind, that's why, because it's tall, it resists the wind. So structures also, even before theory is developed, this concept is developed. And after it is constructed, they developed the theory for this. Frame tubes, actually. Very efficient structural system. Box sections also, we have these rectangular hollow sections and steel square sections, square hollow section. There we are aware of the shear lag effect, So this is the shear, what is estimated theoretically as per the equation, the actual shear due to stress concentration in the corner will be there. So similarly, the axial forces that we estimate, we'll be overestimating here in the central zone and underestimating at the corner zones. So this is the effect of this stress concentration. So actual stress due to shear lag will be higher in the corners. So this is a very, very intricate thing, important, interesting things for structural engineers, at least, I would say. So this is a tube, frame tube example, ion center, and then brace tubes stiffen the widely spaced columns by diagonal bracings where it is required as per the planning. So this is the brace tube load path, like a truss only. And this is the John Hancock Center, is the brace tube concept actually, where the more windows are required here, this is a office building, you can see, and then so that's why they had to increase the spacing of the column, but you will have the higher stresses in the columns, so you have to use the bracing to reduce the forces in the column, shear effect on the column. And we have this bundle tube. This is another important observation you should do in the bundle tube. In fact, these bamboo trees, you will never see one single bamboo, It is always multiple bamboos because they act together. So the same concept was used for this bundle tube, interestingly, in Chicago, Sears Towers. And so here you can see 91 to 108, these two tubes are there. And 67 to 90, these three tubes will be buttressing this. And 51 to 66, these green tubes will be buttressing the whole thing. And 1 to 50, this is the square. So this is the, and this also has the effect of staggering, So because of this staggering, you will be reducing the wind force on the structure. So this is the force diagram for this bundle tube. And so this is how we estimate the forces. You can calculate these forces manually first, the stresses, and then also take into account the shear lag effect and all, and then estimate. This is the Sears Tower in Chicago, which breaks the monotony of the mass, Yeah, that's right, Bangladesh. Father of high-rise buildings. Yeah, some people, that's right. Sears Tower. Sears Towers, you can see it now, yeah. So tube-in-tube system also is next, but not very efficient compared to bundle tube. So this is the West Madison 50-story with the tube-in-tube. So this is the tube in tube, and a diagrid is one example is this cyber texture egg shaped building, and then super frame. So this is the World Trade Center. Sorry, it is written Chicago, it is New York actually, copy paste error. Modified brace tube systems. So this is the Space Trust, Bank of China, where you can see the structure is used as a aesthetic element, you know. This is the one of the best and pleasing designs I like actually. And then you have the exoskeleton. This is a hotel in Barcelona. This is the exoskeleton which I have shown. You have the braced columns and you have the braced truss. So this is the truss and column, but acts as a exoskeleton structure. And the buttress core, next. This is the, this is what I said, the most fascinating structure in the world now. And the, you know, the concept of this core is a hexagonal shaped core, you know. And the hexagon is the most rigid structural shape actually, as far as torsion or bending in multiple directions is concerned. So he has used the hexagonal core in the center, and I section is, we use it for flexural resistance, is it not? So he has used the I section, you know, this is the I shaped section here. So I section will buttress the core actually. So, and what is this, is this I section will be staggering as like stepped beam. It will be reducing the I section. So the flexure is resisted by I flanges, shear is resisted by the web here, and in three directions primarily, because considering the direction of the wind, this is considered. So the maximum wind direction is in this direction, let us say. So originally he was not given the real height of the structure, the structural design. And so he was told it's only 500 meters tall, and the structure was designed, and they have started the foundation. After piling is done, before casting of the raft, the structural engineer is informed it is the actual height of the building. Then he has just changed the orientation by 60 degrees to cater to the maximum wind direction, and then he could reduce the wind force on the structure. Such is the beauty of this shape actually. And he has handled the same requirement with the same piles without much change, and the wind forces have come down. And this is that Burj Khalifa. And so this is only to inspire ourselves to see these tallest buildings. Hopefully we all get the opportunity to be part of such, either construction, design, planning. There are so many disciplines in high-rise structure. One of this, if also if you are there, it will be really interesting. So analysis, we have to carry out compulsorily static, dynamic, and even non-linear thing. And also wind and even explosion we have to consider, because it's such an important structure, and the robustness of the structure also is very important. And effect of wind, large scale horizontal movement of free air. And so this is the wind effects. So we have to do the compulsory wind tunnel modeling. Here you can see, so this is the direction of the wind. And if you have orientation like this, your wind forces will be higher. And if you have the orientation like this, you will reduce the wind force. The suction effect is reduced here. That is the idea of this. So here you can see also the surrounding structure's effect on our structure. So all this we have to do to arrive at the most realistic force coefficients for the wind. So we have the effect of wind in on shear, movement, and deflection. And so wind effects on structure, both static and dynamic. Dynamic analysis is very essential, and wind gusts causes fluctuating forces. And so the creating the, what is that? laminar and turbulent. Turbulent effect is very important on the thing. So here you can see the variation of wind pressure. Normal structures we can estimate easily, but as you go tall, the wind forces will go drastically high due to the dynamic effects. And also as you go higher, the wind force, there are no obstruction and wind force will be high. So wind tunnel experiment is compulsory for high-rise buildings, at least beyond 30 floors. Compulsory, it is better to do it. So this is the wind tunnel test done for Burj Khalifa in Dubai. And so this is the same Davenport's RWDA wind tunnel thing. And so this is a very interesting diagram, video actually. You can see the effect of wind. And this is the how the wind affects when you have two buildings. So wind coefficients, if you just take as per IS 875, you will not be realistic. If you want more accurate wind force coefficient, we have to do the wind tunnel studies. In wind tunnel studies, we get the reaction at the base and also the force coefficient on the structure. You can assess by doing, and also for facades, complicated facade in the buildings, we have to do the wind tunnels test to know the realistic force on the facade actually. Yeah, RWDA Canada. So see this in the plan. If you have multiple high-rise building, what will be the effect of wind? So it's such a complex scenario. If you just take in isolation your structure alone and estimate the forces, it will not be realistic. Can you see this? No. In India, you have many tests now. Kanpur has got, and even recently when I said about RWDA in Trivandrum, there are many other you should test, check actually. There, it's not only one. You have in India 5-6 wind tunnel tests that can be done. But they have their limitations and all. We have to check that limitations and then do it. So this is how the wind testing for facade and windows you can do realistically. And this is the earthquake modeling shake table test. When we go for shake table test, we go for the modeling, model studies actually. So it's based on some existing assumptions. What happens if the assumption? Yeah, we have to consider all the worst case possible. If you think that any new structure that can happen, we have to consider that and also design the structure, because such tall buildings we have to design for at least 150 years life, return period, and what is going to happen in the surroundings in 150 years, that we have to do. And dynamic actions we have to consider, and wind and earthquake, how this is called the accelerogram, you know. And this is the earthquake ground movement. You can see there is a sudden impact and then slowly it dies down. Whereas the wind, you will have the continuous. So the accelerogram we have to take, and when we design these tall buildings, there are cases where they have incorporated these accelerograms and actuators, you know, dynamic damping is done, controlled, tuned mass dampers, and controlled actuators and all that. Yeah, that's right, Ram. Namaste, sir. Thank you, sir. That's very good information. I know. I also heard about it. Srinivas Iyengar from Bangalore. Thank you, sir. Good information. So this is about wind and earthquake, the difference. You should understand the nature of the force when we are designing the structure. So in case of earthquake, you will have sudden release of energy and then damping of that energy. And also the structural system should be having the damping for this sudden impact. And then similarly, if it is a blast, for example, you will have the force like this. So this is the kind of forces, inertial forces and acceleration we have to consider for the design and analysis. Primarily, we have to check the story drift and interstory drift. We have to have the roof is displaced 1 foot in relation to the floor below. That is very high actually. And so this is how we calculate the story drift. And this is what I said, windows, when you have the story drift. We have colleges, institutions actually. SCRC has the shake table test, CPRA has got the shake table test. And please check what you call, please check the Google for the latest information always. And this is the shear lag effect I have explained before, and dynamic analysis. We have done, yeah, this is for the real practical thing I'm giving, sharing information. We have done one real high, some 30-storied structure, wherein we have used the shear walls. We planned very efficiently the buttressed core concept we have used in the structure, in fact, without knowing buttressed core. After I designed the structure, when I visited Burj Khalifa, then I realized I have designed buttressed core. That name I didn't know, but intuitively, we had the core in the center and we had the shear walls and we had corridor connecting this block. So what we did is we have given a stiff beams. In fact, the client asked me, why you are giving such a deep beam? I said, I want to support the core with this shear wall. That really helped in reducing the forces. But the question is, how do you model the shear wall in STAD or this one? You are not supposed to use the plate element, that I always tell. So I am explaining why we cannot use the. So if you use a plate element, this is the model you will be doing. And these are the forces at the base, shear at the base. So maximum shear observed is 620 kN in the column, if you use plate element. And this is the, if it is total shear wall, this is the stress contour actually, shear in the wall. And maximum moment is 2780 is the in the columns. And the moments at the base of the building is this 2780. And we have plotted these forces. I'll try to explain. Land price, yeah, that's right. So this is the mode shapes, mode shape 2, and this is the mode shape 3. When you do the analysis, and this is the mode shape 3. And now this is the variation due to modeling actually. So this is the type of, depending on the type of shear wall, if you have beam column, the forces are maximum axial force is 9,000. And if you use plate element, you can see you will be underestimating the axial force. It is below 8,000 kilonewtons. And equivalent braced frame, if you do, this is the force. We are close to that. So it's very important to decide about the modeling in high-rise structure. And if you use beam column variation of moment, if you use the plate element, you will be having estimating higher moment. And then if in the shear force, you will estimate the higher shear force. So this is the difference, because axial force is very important. You will be underestimating the axial force by using the plate element. That's what I'm trying to say. And equivalent beam column is always better. It will give you more realistic forces. I hope I have conveyed this. So you have to model the shear wall as the equivalent column and beam. If you have any doubt, anybody is designing, you can discuss with me about this issue. And base isolation system, when there is no base isolation and when there is a base isolation, this is the difference in the deformation you can see. So the base isolation is very important for high-rise structures. And construction phase of high-rise buildings, because we should not design any high-rise structure or structural systems without considering the construction methodology, because the time management is very important, and also buildability, the availability of cranes, availability of material handling system is very important in high rise structures, and quality management, because we are dealing with a high risk, the quality level should be very high. And the building information modeling we have to use, because a lot of services, you have the service floors. This is another important thing. When you plan high rise buildings beyond 20 floors, you must have a service floor, because for fire, for water supply, all that, every 20 floors we keep one service floor and use that for all these common things like water storage or water supply, fire tanks, and even the elevators and all that. So construction planning of high rise buildings, technologies used for high rise buildings, we use normally this optimum transportation system with large capacity and high speed equipment. This is for material handling in high rise. Utilize optimum formwork systems for various shapes of the building. And we also use auto climbing or self climbing and a jump form and all that. And rebar prefabrication is very important. And detailing considering this prefabrication is also important. And we have high performance concrete, is, as I said, we have to design for 150 years. And so high durability requirements, high modulus and pumping requirements, because we have to pump for Burj Khalifa. They have designed a special pump to pump up to 500 meters high. Advanced concrete pumping technology and a simple drop head formwork systems, because the cycle time is very important. So you have to have the prop in position and formwork designed with prop in position, that is drop head, and column wall proceeding method, part of aluminum formworks. So these are the auto climbing formwork systems that you can consider for quick de-slip. This is for quick stripping and moving. This is auto climbing formwork, and rebar prefabrication is very important, and also refuse. Yeah, that's right, Raghuaya. So this is the prefabricated rebar and advanced concrete pumping things, concrete pumps, and drop head systems that we use. This is the formwork with the drop head. You can see, you can strip the form while prop is in position. And the simple drop head systems, you can see here, the panel is removed while the prop is in position. And the major equipments that we use are tower cranes and tower main hoists and concrete pumping equipments. And so this is about metal handling and hoists and construction methods. Precast flat panel system also we can use up to even 30-40 floors. We can use this precast panel, and sometimes composite decks are used, and also up to 50 floors you can go for composite structure like columns, infill concrete or encased columns and all that. So this is a precast flat panel system. And 3D volumetric construction like modular and tunnel forms you can use for residential things. And flat slabs, we use it for, like you will have this external structure for wind resistance and flat slab for what you call vertical roads. And hybrid construction we can do like concrete, precast and steel. So precast concrete, pre-stressed concrete, post-tensioning or pre-stressed. So you have the disorganized methods, which is very dangerous, and you should go for organized construction. And safety in high rise is very important. So fire resistance for design of these high rise structures, exterior bearing walls, you know, there should be, because whichever affects the that's right, sir. Taipei. And exterior bearing walls, 3 to 4 hours fire rating. Interior, 2 to 4 hours. And columns, 2 to 4 hours fire rating. and beams, girders, trusses, it should be 2 to 4 hours, and floors will be 2 to 3 hours, and roof is 1.5 to 2 hours. So this is the fire rating, because the fire rating affects the cover to concrete. And also, if we are using steel in the construction, we have to use the intumescent paint for the steel structures necessarily to increase the fire rating of the steel structure. So fire safety, one is fire protection. We have the life safety, egress, that is escape routes and all that, pressurization of protected spaces and all. And 125, so inbuilt, you should have portable extinguishers, manual hydrant systems and fixed automatic system, and the firemen used things. So shear wall considered as core wall connected with staircase. Yeah, why not we do that. Accommodates large number of families and business houses. They reduce the distance to be traveled by occupants. But in spite of all these advantages, the high rise should be the last option. And construction cost increases drastically. Difficult. We have to do the value engineering with the high rise and other options. Actually, the response characteristics of the gust, anemometers, and natural variability of the peak gust tend to be incorporated into the wind load estimate. So these are the projects that we have done. As I said, this is a residential tower of 2 cellars, ground, and 24 floors. And this is the model of the structure. So we have this central core, staircase lift central core, and we have proposed these shear walls, which are buttressing the central core. And the steel consumption, this is in Hyderabad, which we have designed, and the steel consumption has was very optimal, actually, I would say. So this is the plan of the structure where we have influenced in the design to take the shear walls down, and we have given only one opening for the driveway in the shear wall, and the rest was all planned with this. So this is the parking. You can see the shear wall has gone into the parking also. So never use the transfer girders or transfer slab for the shear wall. So this is the typical structural floor plan. And so this is the photograph of the completed structure. So this is another structure we have done, about 15 floors plus 3 basements, and complete. This is a rigid monolithic construction, actually. That is MYVON, using MYVON shuttering. And this is also very advantageous in terms of time planning and quality assurance. And here also you can see we have continued the shear walls down, the main shear walls here. We have not taken the total transfer system here. So this is possible. You can plan the parking, and you can have the rigid monolithic above. This is to facilitate faster construction and reduce the number of activities in the construction also. So there is no plaster to the walls inside and outside. This we have used for another project also recently in low-cost construction also. We have done using this rigid monolithic construction. External walls, we have used the concrete walls, and internal partitions, we have gone for masonry. But we have used the ribbed slab, you know, that is not a ribbed floor actually, but a beam we have designed as a rib back. So we have eliminated the total wall to save on the time and cost of the shuttering also. Yeah, there is no brickwork in this system. So these are the examples of the projects that we have done. And this is the typical floor plan. Here what we did is we have taken the shuttering for this one quarter of the plan. So we have 15 floors, and we have considered a 6-day cycle. So 90 days for each quarter. So in 1 year, we complete the 15 floors. So this is how we planned. Otherwise, you can buy the whole floor shuttering also, but resource leveling and all will be difficult. So you have to consider the resource leveling, shuttering, capital cost, and also time required. Do you require to complete this tower within 90 days, really? like 56 into 15 floors, 90 days you can complete also. But the cost of shuttering will be 4 times. Instead of spending 2 crores on the shuttering, you will be spending 8 crores on the shuttering. So the cost of shuttering per square feet will go up to, square feet of farm will go up to 60 rupees if you go for full shuttering in one tower. So that's why, yeah, that's right, sir. Adjacent to the structures, that is the important thing. So this is the project we did, and this is another project we did, Pranam, with only sheer core and the frame. This is up to 10 floors with two parking floors. And this is also foundations with the isolated thing. And this is the structural system, and this is the completed photograph of the structure. And GVK1 is another project we did, of course, 15 years old. But this has 5 basements and 6 floors, total 11 floors. The floor height-wise, it is 4 meters floor. So we have 30 plus, almost 45 meters tall building. And you have this aquarium and all these features like connecting bridge. And expansion, why I'm sharing this is mainly treatment of expansion joint and also the sacrificial slab that we have used for earthquake design. Because Hyderabad falls in zone 2, but still the estimated deformation due to earthquake has come to almost, because it's a flat slab structure, we have got about 500 mm or 300 mm displacement due to earthquake. So what we did is this expansion joint, this is the expansion joint, and we have used a sacrificial slab. That means the frame distance in the expansion joint is about 900 mm, clear spacing. And in this 900 mm, we have put 1 meter 75 thick slab. So that we have allowed it to fail when there is an earthquake. So thereby you will reduce the damage to the structure, main structure. You will lose this slab and flooring in that area. So this is a concept we have used in the expansion joint. So this kind of techniques we can, here is the detail of the floor expansion joint. So how to cast this expansion joint also, we have given the details. Sorry, this is a column strengthening, different thing. So these are the staggered lap details, and this is the, also, we have a parking double helical ramp for the parking, and parking access and all are also important. So this is the one of the blocks with the expansion joint here. So this is the overall plan of the structure. We had the two expansion joints here and here. Because of this shape, we had to introduce this expansion joint. Otherwise, if it is a regular shape, we can design, you can see, due to the earthquake, there are some issues regarding torsion and all also, and we got, we have introduced that sacrificial slab at this point and this shape. And this is the double helical ramp. So very interesting structure we did. So that's why I thought of sharing. And probably this was the largest PT structure in Hyderabad, first PT structure in Hyderabad. We introduced after doing value engineering, presenting to the client about advantages of PT. So these are photographs during construction of the GVK1, and here you can see the expansion joint. And so this is the double helical ramp, circular double helical ramp, and construction phasing. Here another important thing we did was, there are no starters here, no kicker. So we have designed the shuttering. We insisted that because the estimated load on the column was 4,000 tons. So I didn't want to take any chance. Otherwise, I insisted the contractor to use micro concrete for the starter or use the flow mix with the design mix separately, because you can't vibrate the starters in any of the buildings. Starter is a menace, actually. You will see the highest stress zone, you will see the honeycomb set because of the starters. So you should have a very method statement very clearly defining to ensure that this is not having the honeycombs, because you can never match two surfaces. So you should have the packing system for the formwork when you use the starter, and also starter concreting itself is a tough thing. So that's very important. Please ensure that. So this is what we implemented in this project also, and almost all and facade treatment and facade design is also very important factor in this project that we have done. This is though it is delayed, it was completed. And and what is your experience? Could you ensure Seshagiri the joints proper? Have you ever tested any core sample at the starter level? Please take the core sample for testing. No, 20 mm also is not. In fact, if you put the pin vibrate, you tell me 75 mm concrete, how you can compact with pin vibrate? That is the issue actually. Please, okay, I'm happy if you can develop the right construction method and get the good concrete. I am the happy as an engineer. But you take one core sample and test, please. One core sample. After casting above the starter, at the junction you take the core. And if you get the real strength, I will certify that. High-rise apartment, you will face a harder challenge trying to evacuate due to emergencies such as natural. Yeah, that's right. Disaster or fire. How to come out of this? Yeah, we have to plan the fire evacuation as per the NBC norms. We avoid starter in all vertical member. We always system shutter. Kicker is not required. That's right. That's right. And what are available 3D animation model software to compute the wind tunnel effects? I really did not try. So I took it from the Google only. Good quality, not by seeing, Seshagiri. You have to take the core sample and test. Then only it is good quality. We can cast monolithic kickers during slab pour. Yeah, that's possible, but the very purpose of kicker is to, if you can cast the kicker along with the slab, then why kicker at all? Because position has to be fixed properly, and if you can have that bracket, you better use the formwork with the bracket. Elastic shortening, yeah, that's very important. I missed it, Sayed. In fact, the creep I mentioned in the beginning, you have to consider the creep. And that is elastic shortening, and we have to do the creep correction and this one. So, any other questions? So, if there are no other questions, thank you very much. And what is the steel consumption? Yeah, we have done, as I said, the 26-storied building with 3.4 kg per square feet of steel consumption. And even 15-storied building with 3.1 kg per square feet in Hyderabad, of course. Maintenance issues, yeah, have to be considered. For drain water falling from such a height, no, we have to have the downtake pipes. During wind ponding effect should also be considered. Yeah, that's why I have shown the wind tunnel studies. What will be the concrete grade of starter? Yeah, it should be same as column or shear wall. Yeah, that's right. SCRC, CSIR have got. What do you suggest to overcome these challenges of ventilation, parking space? Yeah, we have to have the forced air ventilation in parking, and we have to have the forced air. No, every high-rise building, we have to do the value engineering, considering the construction aspects and the structural efficiency. Yeah, you have to be innovative and intuitive as an engineer to develop the new ideas. You know, you have to keep thinking about that. Concrete quality above starter. Yeah, just at the starter and column junction, you take a core and then test that core. So thank you all. I'll conclude for the day. and see you on Monday. We are left with only 3 lectures in this stage 2. Adjoining buildings constructed later. Yeah, that we have to consider the master plan of the city, and then that's very important for high rise. What is going to happen in future, and then in generally master plan will be done for 20 years, but there should be a development control norms for such high rise structures, and you cannot allow a free for all kind of construction around such tall building. PT slab and the normal RCC building, how much steel difference? Almost 20% change will be there in the slabs. Yeah, water supply has to be taken care of. Normally you use hydropneumatic system for such high-rise building. 20 floors, every 20 floors one system we design. So thank you very much. I'm concluding for the day. And if you have any further questions, you can ask in the messenger. Thank you. Bye.